this weekend. But I was talking to the counselor about it, and he said that
can I interrupt briefly just to set levels with the musician?
Sure.
Sage, are you there?
No.
Nikki said that we're on Facebook Live now.
Hey, Sage, can you hear me? I can't hear you yet. Nope, still not. Let's see. What microphone is it say you're using in Zoom?
For now.
All right, I'm going to share my screen. And let's see. Oh, I can't share my screen. Oh, try that again. I can hear your violin. Now, have you ever done any Zoom streaming before? Did you do all the little audio setting things that you're supposed to do as a musician? Have you been told about this? Like disabling the background noise and the intermittent noise? I can barely hear you talking. Are you playing a background track right now?
How about now?
Yeah, I can hear that microphone.
Okay, cool. Awesome. I got to turn this up. So, awesome. Cool. I'm playing a background track right now. Can you guys hear that?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Awesome. Is it a pretty good volume for you guys?
I'd bring it up another 5% or so.
Okay, because Zoom does boost the volume on these, and I don't want it to distort. Okay, so I boosted it there. Let me know what you think.
All right. Play with your violin and let me...
Okay.
Go ahead and bring the background track down back to where it was. Your violin could probably come up just a wee bit. In between where it was and where it's at. Yeah. I think you can go with that.
Rad, awesome.
And then you've done all that weird advanced audio setting stuff.
I think I have, but you might want to walk me through it just in case.
All right. You know, go to the settings screen where you can choose your audio, adjust your audio settings.
Okay.
First thing you see under the microphone where it says automatically adjust volume.
Let's see here. Hang on just a second. It says settings. Okay. All right. And I'm now looking at the settings.
All right, you see where it says automatically adjust volume underneath your volume for your microphone?
Let's see here.
Nobody wants to hear you.
That should be turned off.
Okay.
And then in the lower right, you see the advanced button?
Yes, sir.
Go to that.
Okay.
Do you see the suppress persistent background noise? And the intermittent background noise, disable both of those.
Okay, I have those both disabled.
Okay. And then you have show in meeting option to enable original sound for microphone.
Yes, sir.
That should be enabled with a check mark.
Uh-huh. So no check mark then.
All right. Make it a check mark for original sound.
Yeah, I got that check marked.
All right. And then you've got original sound turned on when you go back to your main screen. Up in the left-hand corner of just your regular window, it should say turn on original sound or turn off.
Yeah, it says turn off original sound right now. That means it's on, right?
Right. You're perfect. You already got everything on lockdown.
Cool, man.
All right. I'm going to mute myself. Guy Niederhauser, you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
He's the MC today. I'll let him touch base with you and how to introduce you. And I'll start sharing your stuff in like the chat for, you know, if anybody wants to tip you, and we'll get this ball rolling.
I appreciate it. Thank you guys for having me.
Thank you. This is awesome.
Yeah, Sage, welcome. I'm sort of the MC. We got a whole crowd here watching us here, but anything that you want me to say about you, I'm just gonna be introducing you here. Any information? I'm gonna give your Facebook information here, your Rage with Sage Facebook page. Any other information you need me to say about you, or you want me to say about you?
Just say that I have new releases on iTunes, which you can find me. Just type in name on iTunes and Spotify, that whole thing. And pretty much that's it. I'm a fiddle player from Kansas, now living in New Mexico.
Oh, you're in New Mexico. Okay, awesome. Well, we'll have the floor will be yours once you've got it, and you obviously the most yours, you can say whatever you want. So we're gonna go ahead and get started here. So good morning, everyone. Welcome to Kansas City Oasis, Kansas City's premier alternative to faith-based community. I think we're still calling ourselves that. So hello, everyone. Let's give a little wave to everybody. Say hello to your fellow friends and family and everybody from all around the world. Now I know we've got somebody from New Mexico. Welcome, Sage, and everybody else. Familiar faces and those that aren't so much. JJ just threw up our musician, Sage Cornelius's information for Venmo and Cash App, ways that we can support our musicians and our artists. So throw that out there. Once you hear, it sounds like we're going to get some banging music this morning. So what is our program for you this morning? As you heard JJ say, my name's Guy Niederhauser. I'm a member of the board here at Kansas City Oasis, and I'm going to be your MC for this morning. I know a bunch of you know me already, so I won't go into a big old thing. So what do we got for today? Our speaker for this morning is Annie Lawler. She has a presentation about succulents and cacti. She has a group called Chubby Plant People, the weird and wonderful world of succulents. She's going to tell us all about how to not drown or starve our succulents of their needs, which I know I'm very much interested in because I have tried time and time again to bring some color into my home with some green, and it fails miserably. So around my kitchen, I have fake plants. They're hanging behind me. You can see them. So I'd like to get some live plants in my house. So I'm very interested in this conversation. Our community moment is from another fellow board member, Mark Dixon, who's been with Oasis, I believe, since the very beginning. He's going to be talking about I don't know what, but I assume that it will be very interesting. Mark has an interesting history of what got him to Oasis. I know he's been around town. He's tried out a lot of different faith and religious and spiritual communities. And so he's always got something good to say. So we're going to hear from Mark Dixon here very shortly. And of course, I just introduced very haphazardly there our musical guest, Sage Cornelius from New Mexico. So we're going to go ahead and get started with some music because that just titillated my little brainy bit. So Sage, if you will take it away, let's hear some music from you, please. Everybody welcome Sage Cornelius to Kansas City Oasis.
Thank you guys very much. All right, here we go. Let's rock. Let's wake everybody up. Awesome. Once again, my name is Sage Cornelius. I'm currently residing in Albuquerque, New Mexico, originally from Topeka, Kansas, and it's my pleasure to be here today. Thank you, guys. Thank you.
This is how we show our appreciation over Zoom. Silent claps. Okay, that was amazing. Oh my God, I did not know what to expect. That was a please take it. Keep going, Sage. Take it away.
Awesome. Thank you guys. So I grew up playing guitar as well, and so I'm like sort of like came to this point where I'm blending both styles of like violin and also rock kind of guitar. You guys heard the wah pedal. This is a song that is currently up on my YouTube. This is a song I produced, but obviously is not mine. This is a remix that I did on I Got Five on it. Hope you guys dig it. Here we go. Thank you.
Okay, my God, what in, I don't know. I don't even know what to say. I don't know how to respond to that. What, okay, give me a little rundown. Okay, and I say me, I mean us. What are you doing over there?
What are you running
over there? You said wah pedal. You said you were a guitar player turned working on the violin. How did you bring it together? What are you doing over there?
I'm a bluegrass fiddler. I heard The Devil Went Down to Georgia, and I wanted to learn how to play violin ever since I heard that great song. And then my dad, we went on a fishing trip when I was like 14, and he had like Ride the Lightning, Metallica's Ride the Lightning. And then like I just like sort of like through life just started like blending the two together, you know, the attitude and the rawness of like the metal aspect, and also like the free form make it yourself that bluegrass brings kind of to the table. And so, yeah, for right now, I'm just, you know, based out of here with COVID shutting everything down. I'm obviously doing more Zoom performances. But before that, you know, I love to play on the street. I love to busk. I have my little robots here that I'll take out on the street with me and, you know, usually play on the weekends and everything. But, yeah, so that's what I got going on so far.
Nice. This is it's so original. It's so artistic. It's so creative. I can speak, I think, on behalf of all the nodding heads as you're playing. I think you got a dime or two coming your way this morning. It's so great. I can't wait to hear some more. Thank you so much.
Appreciate you, brother. Thank you.
All right. So we're going to keep this going. Yeah, we can keep some more claps. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. All right. So I got some announcements here for Oasis. First of all, we are streaming here on Facebook Live as well. We're on Zoom, but we have now got Facebook Live streaming as well. So we can have this into eternity, so long as Facebook continues. We have a couple birthdays this week. Daniel Sherwood and Judy Bishop had birthdays this week. So yay, happy birthday. We're not gonna sing because I don't want to sing happy birthday. I'm the only one unmuted and I don't want to sing happy birthday because that's weird. So happy birthday to them. If you see them and know them, send them a little notification, blow them up. What else we got? The Kansas City Oasis Community Pantry is still always ongoing. If you or anyone else in the Oasis community that you know is struggling with any need for resources, for food, for assistance of any kind during shutdown, during quarantine, during this pandemic, don't hesitate to get a hold of anybody from the board of directors, from the care response team, and we will do our best to reach out to our community and find you what you need if we are able to do so. So please, if you have anything, send a message via Facebook Messenger or through an email to any of the board members, and we will do our best to find what you need during these challenging times. Kansas City Oasis Community Pantry is still ongoing, okay? The after dinner Zoom chats are still happening Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. You can follow this link, this Zoom link to this Zoom chat, and meet up with other Kansas City Oasis folks and chat with them. If you're missing your friends because they're in quarantine or you haven't seen them in a minute, you can find them here on Wednesday nights after dinner. And at 7:30 every morning for coffee, you can find them right here as well. Sometimes it's just a couple folks. Sometimes it's a handful of folks. Sometimes we're infiltrated by people we don't know. So if Steph knows what that's about. So you can find people here Wednesday nights at 8 o'clock and 7:30 every morning. Marlis told us that she is overwhelmed with yellow squash and zucchini. So if anybody's interested in some free vegetables, let her know via Facebook that you're interested. She's willing to set them out on the porch and you can come by and pick up some free vegetables, fresh vegetables. All right. And last announcement, Mark Dixon is currently in need of Community Moment speakers. We are always in need of speakers. We're usually months out in lining people up, but right now we're in a lull. So if you have anything that you'd like to share with your community, any original thoughts, any stories about your life or your experiences that you want to share with your Oasis community members, get a hold of Mark Dixon. You can send him a Facebook message or send him an email to his Kansas City Oasis email. Is that mark.dixon? That's right, mark.dixon@kcoasis.org. And we'll get you set up for a community moment. Speaking of which, I think we're about to head right into that. So our community moment here at Kansas City Oasis is a time when somebody from our community tells us a little something about themselves. tells us a little bit more about themselves, shares an experience or part of who they are, so we can get to know each other a little bit more. Almost everybody here has heard this spiel a number of times, but if you haven't, this is a chance when we get to know each other a little bit more. This is how we maintain our friendship, especially from a distance. So this has become a really important part of our Sunday gatherings, so that we don't lose touch with one another. So this morning we have Mark Dixon, our board member, longtime member at Oasis. And as I introduce him, we usually ask for three words to describe our community moment speakers and a warning label. I got these from Mark this morning, and I was a little surprised to get these words that he chose for himself, or I don't know if Cheryl gave him these words, but the three words that I was given to describe Mark are adventurous, curious, and verbal, and his warning label, not nearly as calm as I appear. So everybody, please welcome Mark Dixon.
Good morning, everyone. I think Guy may have built this up a little bit too much earlier in his comments. This is just something I hope will be a little bit lighthearted and fun, and I hope interesting to enough people. I'm calling this presentation today, What a Difference a Year Can Make, and I do hope you'll enjoy it. So it's pretty clear that 2020 has been a year of big changes with the pandemic and its economic fallout, social unrest over racial injustice, police brutality, of course, our ongoing national election season, which you could argue is a battle for the soul or even the survival of our nation. And it's only July 5th. So much has been going on that even the murder hornets arriving on our shores barely made the news cycle. Can you believe it was only 5 months ago on February 2nd when the Chiefs won the Super Bowl? It feels like an eternity ago. It's been a strange half year. Well, while 2020 will no doubt earn a long chapter in some future U.S. history textbook, other years are periods of more subtle but lasting change. Today, I want to focus on the year 1969. And it's interesting why I'm picking that year. It had some meaning for me, but also just over time, I kept seeing news stories or seeing documentaries and things. And the year 1969 kept coming up repeatedly. So I could have certainly picked any other year in the volatile 1960s or even a year in some other decade. So it was really just serendipity. I kept running across references to events that took place in 1969. I was aware of some of them already and then decided to dig a little deeper. For some of the younger folks online today, probably most of our crew, some of this may be new information. For the older folks like me, it's a trip down memory lane. Whether or not it's a good trip or a bad trip is hard to say. Anyway, so let me set the stage a little about 1969. So the average cost of a new house in 1969 was $15,550 in the US. Average rent, monthly rent, was $135. The average annual income per year was $8,550. Average cost of a new car, a little over $3,200, and you could get yourself a shiny new Toyota Corona for a whopping $1,950. And gas for that new Corona was 35 cents a gallon. So obviously the proverbial American dream was much more affordable, but was it really a simpler time? So here are just a few things that happened that year, some impactful today even to this day, others that I just found interesting. So these are in date order. On January 20th, the now infamous Richard "I Am Not a Crook" Nixon was inaugurated as the President of the United States, as we all know, later to resign in disgrace over the cover-up of the Watergate break-in. On January 30th, the Beatles gave their final live performance along with Billy Preston from the rooftop of the Apple Records building in London. February 9th saw the first flight of the Boeing 747 jumbo jet, with commercial flights beginning the following year. It was notable because it had three times the capacity as its predecessor, the Boeing 707, and it held the passenger capacity record for 37 years. I actually had the pleasure of flying in a nearly empty 747 some years ago on a business trip with a coworker all the way from JFK Airport in New York to San Francisco. It was quite an interesting flight. Very, very, very empty, very, very large plane. On May 19th, the same day that his conviction for marijuana possession was overturned by the Supreme Court in declaring the Marijuana Tax Act unconstitutional, psychologist, author, and LSD proponent, Dr. Timothy Leary, he was quite a character. He announced his candidacy that day for governor of California against Republican incumbent Ronald Reagan. His campaign slogan was, "Come together, join the party." His friend John Lennon subsequently wrote Leary a campaign song called, you may have guessed it, "Come Together." It's actually written as a campaign song for Timothy Leary. On June 28th, police raided the Stonewall Inn, a gay club located in New York City, which, as most of us know, kicked off a series of rebellions and riots, and it's widely considered to be the most important event leading to the gay liberation movement and the modern fight for LGBTQ plus rights in the US. At around midnight on July 18th or 19th, Senator Edward Ted Kennedy, age 37 at the time, was driving a car that plunged into a pond on Chappaquiddick Island, Massachusetts. Kennedy left the scene and did not report the accident to police until after 10 a.m. the next morning. Later that day, the body of his passenger, Mary Jo Kopechne, was found by a diver. Kennedy eventually pleaded guilty to a charge of leaving the scene of an accident and received a 2-month suspended jail sentence and a 16-month suspension of his driver's license. It's amazing still to this day what a little money and influence will get you out of. Oddly enough, this is one of the first news stories I remember. I was a young boy, but I remember this being all over the news. It was quite a scandal, obviously, a sitting senator involved in that sort of an incident. It was very, very scandalous. On July 20th, Apollo 11 landed on the moon, first moon landing. It's an event that I watched on live TV with friends at my own birthday party. It's on my birthday. Watched it on a portable TV that my dad had rolled out to the patio. The next day, astronaut Neil Armstrong became the first human to set foot on the moon, uttering those immortal words, "That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind." Then throughout July and August, cult leader Charles Manson and his followers committed a series of 9 murders at 4 locations, crimes for which he eventually spent life in prison, dying in 2017 at age 83. And of course, I think everybody's very familiar with Charles Manson. The famous Woodstock Festival, with an estimated 500,000 concert goers, ran from August 15th to August 18th in upstate New York. Wild summer. On September 2nd, Chemical Bank installed the first automatic teller machine, or ATM, in the US at its branch in Rockville Center, New York. On October 29th, the first communication was sent between UCLA and Stanford through the ARPANET, launching what we now know as the internet. This at the same time that designers were beginning to integrate the functions of computer CPUs onto single chip microprocessors, which opened the way, obviously, for the computer revolution that we're still living with today and that allows us to meet by Zoom. All that was going on in 69. On October 31st, Walmart Incorporated as Walmart Stores, Inc. On November 3rd, the Public Broadcasting Service, PBS, was established. On December 1, the U.S. began the draft lottery to determine the draft order of young men into U.S. forces for Vietnam. This was an attempt to address perceived inequities in the predecessor military draft system that the lottery replaced. War protests were already in full swing, including a march on Washington that year with 250,000 participants. And finally, the U.S. Air Force officially closed its 17-year Project Blue Book investigation on December 17th, concluding that UFOs showed no evidence of being extraterrestrial objects. There are still many doubters. So what a year, right? I wonder if any of you might also want to pick a year and do a little research and maybe fill us in on what was going on. Maybe the year you were born. That's my segue into reiterating what Guy had to say, is that we're always looking for community presenters, people that want to talk about hobbies or their profession or something they're just passionate about. Typically, these are 5 to 7 minutes. We're obviously trying to find somebody to do one every Sunday. And I hope you found that at least a little bit entertaining. And if you are game for doing one yourself, just as Guy said, reach out to me by Facebook Messenger or email. Thank you, everyone.
All right. Thank you, Mark. Thank you so much. I will admit I was fascinated by every line that was coming, I was on the edge of my seat to hear what you were going to say next, because I had no idea about the Come Together song. That's an easy song to learn on guitar, so I learned it early on as well. That was fun. Everybody else, I've said it again, Mark just said it, if you're interested in doing a community moment, they can be real simple or they can get real deep and complicated if your name's JJ. Get a hold of Mark, get your head spinning, get your thoughts together, and shoot Mark a message. That being said, we are going to break out into our small groups for in lieu of a 10-minute coffee break. You can grab your own coffee. And we are going to say hello to a couple friends. And here we go. I don't know who's in control of this. Looks like Nikki. So we're going to say hello to a few friends, and we'll be back in our large group in about 10 minutes or so. This meeting is being recorded. Anybody else hear that? No, just me. All right, Sage. Yes,
I was going to do the same thing.
Sage, you ready to hit us again here in a couple minutes or a couple seconds?
Hey, man, let's do it. All just right. Cue.
I'll cue you up here. We're going to make sure everybody's back in here. Everybody come back to the breakout rooms. You should definitely play something instead of me doing that.
Okay, all right.
There you go. That's much better. That's much better than me doing doo-doos.
Go ahead and just let me know whenever.
All right. That's what I'm talking about. All right. So we are back. We have begun the second half of our Sunday gathering. We have Sage Cornelius with us here. He has played a couple songs to begin, and we are going to get started. We're ready for some more music. I'm going to be done playing music with my mouth, and we're going to hear from this. Is this an electric? What are you playing there? What is that? An electric violin?
Playing a 7-string electric violin. This is a Viper. That's what they're called.
7-string electric violin.
Viper. A Viper. That's right. Like the snake.
Yeah. Yeah. I played 5-string basses and 7-string guitars back in the day. And nice. we tried to be as heavy as we could and as loud as we could. And now I can't hear anything. So this is fantastic. That's a badass name for an electric violin. So please, let's get going. Hit us.
Awesome. Just a quick little story on this one. I'm going to play this one without a beat. I had the opportunity to tour with this gentleman by the name of Sean James. If you type in Sean James Gaslight Sessions on YouTube, you'll be able to see some of the works that I've done with him. But in my travels, touring with Sean, going over to Europe, I was lucky enough to tour and get to play in Dublin in Ireland. And it was a very, very awesome opportunity to kind of play some of these songs that were kind of like from the motherland and share that with the people, and also kind of like spin their lids, you know, this American coming over and playing like some traditional Irish kind of sounding stuff. So this is one of my favorite songs to play without a beat. And the song is called Misty Molly.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Absolutely gorgeous. Backtracks are amazing, but hearing that instrument on its own, hearing your talent on its own in pure form was just fantastic. I loved it so much. That's quite an instrument.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate you, man.
Yeah, awesome, awesome. All right, we're going to keep moving. We're going to keep going. We have a fantastic speaker today. I'm very interested myself. I talked about it at the beginning, but we're going to be hearing from Annie Lawler, representing the Chubby Plant people, an introduction to the weird and wonderful world of succulents and cacti. I love alliteration, so that's a great title to this talk for this morning. Annie is a succulent lover, author, artist, and the founder, again, of the Chubby Plant People, an education-based group for succulent lovers and artists. Annie is currently working on a selected encyclopedia and handbook on care for succulents and cacti, and is here today to tell us how to not drown or starve our little green friends. So if everyone would welcome Annie, we're gonna hear what she's got to tell us this morning. So please, everybody, round of applause for Miss Annie Lawler.
Hi guys. All right, so if you wanna take any notes, this is your time to grab some paper and a pencil. This virtual class will cover the basics of my introduction to the weird and wonderful world of succulents and cacti workshop. And if you're following along and taking notes, the main topics that we'll be discussing today are what makes a succulent, basic care information about USDA plant hardiness zones, light, soil, watering, fertilizer, flowering succulents, planting succulents, and the uses for these incredible chubby plants, followed by a Q&A session. So start thinking of questions now. So what makes a succulent? In botany, succulent plants are described as any plants having some part which is more than normally thickened or fleshy, helping them retain water in arid climates, in poor soil conditions, or in areas with unpredictable precipitation. The habits of these water-preserving plants are often in areas with high temperatures and low rainfall. Succulents have the ability to thrive on limited water sources, such as mist and dew, equipping them to survive in an ecosystem which contains scarce water source. The word succulent actually comes from the Latin word succus, meaning juice or sap, continually referencing their water storing abilities. Succulent plants store water in different various structures, such as their leaves or stems, with some definitions also including root structures, adding geophytes or plants that survive unfavorable conditions by dying back to a resting bud on an underground storage organ to the list. These underground organs, such as bulbs, corms, and tubers, are often fleshy with water-storing tissues. Plants adapted to living in dry environments, such as succulents, are called xerophytes. Not all xerophytes are succulent, since there are other ways of adapting to shortage of water, like by developing small leaves which may roll up, or by having leathery rather than succulent leaves. Likewise, neither are all succulents xerophytes, since plants like Crassula hemsley are surprisingly both succulent and aquatic. In horticultural use, however, the term succulent is used in a way which excludes many plants that botanists would regard as succulents, such as cacti. Regardless of your definition, succulents are often grown as ornamental plants because of their striking, unusual, and unique appearances. Over 25 plant families have succulents found within them. In some families, such as Azaleae, Cactaceae, and Crassulaceae, most species are succulent. A practical but oversimplified, unscientific, and horticultural definition of what makes a succulent is simply that a succulent plant is any desert plant that a succulent plant collector wishes to grow. Let's move on to some basic care information. Succulents are amazingly easy plants to grow if you follow a few simple rules. Simply think about the container you're planting in, fertilizer, water, soil, light, and the climate that you're attempting to grow in, and you're nearly guaranteed success. The very first thing to consider is your climate. The USDA Plant Hardiness Zone map is a great guide to help you find plants that will thrive outdoors year-round. Succulents are generally considered to be hardy if they can survive in zones 3 to 9. I live in Los Angeles, where I'm in USDA Plant Hardiness Zone 10A. In zone 10A, almost all succulents can be grown outdoors year-round. But in Kansas City, you're in zone 6, where you'll need to winter most of your succulents indoors. And I have another class specifically about succulents for regions with cold winters. I could talk about this topic for days. To provide the best possible care, think about the climate that your plants would be found in naturally when planting, watering, and positioning your succulents. Most varieties of succulents need at least half a day to a full day of sunlight, meaning they'll do better outdoors than in your sunniest windows. You should also keep in mind that morning light is ideal for almost all plants. In extremely hot areas, some afternoon shade is even recommended to help protect your plants. Afternoon sun can be extremely harsh, especially when reflected off of wide swaths of light-colored walls where many outdoor succulents are displayed, and sunburns can and do happen even on the hardiest of cacti. Sunburns on succulents are usually characterized by unattractive discoloration on the outer surface and cause permanent scarring even if the health of your plants is relatively unaffected by the small burned area. A sunburned succulent cannot photosynthesize through the sunburned tissue patches on its leaves, and in an ironic turn of events, too much sun can actually be damaging or even fatal for your succulents. Most succulents and cacti can generally handle excessive heat or full sun, but the two factors combined can spell trouble. When a succulent is in too much heat and sun, it will become stressed. This is something that many succulent growers actually strive to achieve, as the colors of stressed plants are particularly beautiful and vibrant. If the succulent is introduced to this stress gradually, it may be able to adapt to the extra heat and light by producing these vibrant, brightly colored pigments. But if the increased light is introduced too much all at once, it will likely suffer sunburns. As sunburns develop, you will see the discolored patches appear on the leaves, ranging from pale beige to tan or even black in color. These patches will also have a rough texture, directly at odds with the smooth feel of most succulent leaves. Using shade cloth in the heat of summer is the best way to protect your succulents from damage due to excessive heat and sunlight. Shade cloth is a special fabric designed to help protect your plants from sun damage while still permitting some sunlight to filter through. It helps protect against the buildup of excessive heat in the plant's tissues and blocks a good portion of the direct UV rays. Always introduce your succulents to more light gradually and assume that any new plants that you purchase were heavily protected by shade cloth in their previous homes to avoid issues. Give your new plants bright shade in your garden and move them to more light carefully and very slowly to avoid damage. I recommend adding just an additional half an hour of light every 2 to 3 days and watching your plants very carefully for signs that they want more or less light. After a month or so, most succulents will have acclimated to full sun. During the heat in summer, I do rig shade cloth structures for most of my succulents here in Los Angeles, and I strongly encourage those who garden in other fiercely hot or exposed desert areas to use shade cloth as well. Select a shade cloth that provides at least 35% shade and up to 70% shade, depending on your climate. And keep in mind that shade cloth is graded by the amount of UV light it's able to reflect and not color coordinated to those numbers. You can find any grade of shade cloth in any color you like. Succulents need fast draining soil. When planting in the garden, make sure that the areas drain well and is not in a low spot that would stay wet. It's best to plant succulents in habitat on a slight mound of earth to allow for excessive drainage. For container planting, you can purchase cactus soil mixes, amending and incorporating sand, gravel, perlite, pumice, or other rocks and stones for better drainage depending on the species. As a general rule, I recommend 3 parts of a store-bought cactus mix to 1 part perlite or crushed pumice to increase drainage and encourage healthy growth on your succulents. I have a soil mixture so you can see what your soil really should look like. As you can see, this is mostly rocks and dirt, and that's really what the succulents are going to want. Additionally, the container that you're planting in should have at least 1 drainage hole to allow for ease of care. Closed containers can be used, but they add an additional layer of difficulty to the process. Natural clay pots like terracotta pots are ideal for succulents because they're so porous, keeping the roots dry and ventilated, but that's far from the only option. For low maintenance gardens, choose unglazed ceramic pottery and always make sure you have at least 1 large drain hole. A solid, unbreathable finish or a lack of drainage can be worked around, but both will require extra work. Shallow dishes, bowls, or even teacups are perfect for succulents with shallow root systems. Mounding the soil up in the center of the pot will help with drainage, and a top dressing can be added to help hold soil in place and give your arrangements a professional touch. For those of you who don't know, a top dressing is any sort of decorative rocks or stones. I like to use aquarium gravel sometimes just to add a little zhuzh. It really makes your arrangements look more professional, and it also helps hold the soil in place. Shallow arrangements will need at least a yearly replanting as they outgrow their space. Despite the popular myth, adding a layer of pebbles to the bottom of your container does not promote fast drainage and can actually raise the water table and keep your plant's roots overly moist, causing issues with rot. If you can, especially when planting in unconventional containers, always add your own drainage holes with a diamond bit drill to increase the health of your plant. Metal containers like this cute little hanging guy can be used as long as you drill your own drainage holes. Other than that, you're gonna wanna look for unglazed ceramic pottery with its drainage hole at the bottom. Even though succulents are tough, recycled metal containers can and should be kept in partially shaded areas as they're incredibly easy to heat up, and even roots can be sunburned in the wrong conditions. Be prepared for a little extra maintenance in the way of watering, as many metal containers contain large holes or openings require more regular water. Because of how fast they conduct heat and cold, not all succulents are suitable for metal containers, and cacti will actually do best. Continuing the theme of recycling, styrofoam can be turned into fairly long-lasting and well-insulated planters for succulents and cacti. Any styrofoam containers or bricks can be hollowed out, any holes can be covered with wire to keep the dirt contained, and the outside can be painted any color you want. In time, you'll need to replace your planters as the styrofoam will begin to break down and start to disintegrate naturally in a matter of years. Let's move on to watering, what everybody wants to know about succulents. After planting, you'll want to always water your succulents in very well, watching for the water to run out of the bottom drainage holes to ensure that the soil is fully soaked before resuming a normal watering schedule. Your normal watering schedule will always allow the soil to dry out between waterings. And always empty your drip trays, the succulent may sit on a few minutes after watering, to avoid any potential issues with rot from sitting in standing water. Succulents do not like having wet feet at any time. When you do water your plants, you'll want to water thoroughly, but still allow the soil to dry completely between waterings. If you're unsure when to water, you can stick a wooden dowel or skewer an inch or two into the soil, pulling it up to be sure that the soil is thoroughly dry. A skewer that comes out clean means the soil is thoroughly dry and ready to be watered. Most succulents require more water in the early spring when the plant is actively growing, and the water needs may lessen in the summer or winter depending on the natural rainfall patterns the plant sees in habitat. Most succulents are either summer or winter rainfall plants, and because of this, many succulents enter a period of dormancy in either summer or winter, in which growing will cease and water is needed much less frequently. Even during these periods of dormancy, you'll still want to water your succulents whenever the soil is dry. However, this could be as infrequently as monthly, depending on your local growing conditions. Outdoor plants generally require more water than indoor plants. Again, your conditions and your container that you've planted in will dictate how often your succulents need water. Start out by checking your plants on a weekly basis, paying close attention to the conditions the potting medium is and how fast it dries. Fertilizer. Most succulents need very little fertilizer, and this is actually an optional amendment. You can raise very healthy succulents without ever introducing fertilizer to them. Watering with a well-balanced fertilizer or a liquid plant food once a month is the most that any succulents will ever need. Over-fertilizing can lead to saggy, limp growth and discoloration, and it's unfortunately easy to do on indoor plants. I only recommend supplemental fertilizer for most outdoor plants, especially for succulents and cacti. While succulents can get most of the nutrients they need straight from the soil, the additional fertilizer will help them grow more full and produce more spectacular colors. You do have to be careful not to use a fertilizer that's too strong, otherwise the chemicals can cause your succulents to burn. The right mild fertilizer used every few months can dramatically change how well your succulents thrive outdoors. But again, I do not recommend this for indoor plants. Manure tea is an amazing all-natural fertilizer that won't chemically burn your succulents even in large amounts. The idea behind manure tea is great. It's just like using compost or manure to add nutrients to the soil, but it's not messy and it doesn't stink. Overall, it's a great all-natural way to fertilize succulents. The process is simple. Manure tea is sold in tea bags ready to go and is available online and in specialty gardening centers across this country. Simply remove the tea bag from its packaging, place it in a 5-gallon bucket filled nearly to the top with water, cover the bucket and let the tea bag sit and steep in the water for a few days. After 2 to 7 days, open the bucket back up and remove your spent tea bag. Then you can begin fertilizing. The tea is mild enough that it won't burn your succulents if it gets on top of the leaves, like many chemical fertilizers will. Pour your brewed tea into a large watering can and generously share it amongst your succulents, just like you would with any other watering. If you decide to use something other than manure tea for your succulent fertilizer, stay far away from most slow release options, and especially far away from Miracle-Gro. These are extremely potent, and they can often inadvertently burn your succulents rather than helping them to grow. I recommend using a water-soluble fertilizer like Cactus Juice brand, diluted to half the recommended strength. All right. So succulents all have different bloom times and can be extremely colorful, showing pink, red, orange, yellow, green, or white blooms. Many will only bloom after the second or third year when they reach maturity, and other plants, known as monocarpic plants, only bloom once in a spectacular terminal display before scattering their seeds and dying. A flower stalk will shoot up from the center of the main rosette of many succulents with a cluster of flowers, or it may sprout from the tips of other species. After the flowers die, you can gently twist them off the stalk. The main rosette will put off new offsets that will begin to fill in. Succulent plants are mainly grown for the attractive structures of their fat stems, leaves, or roots, which gives lasting interest. But flowers are a wonderful bonus and a surprising seasonal addition. Succulents can be shy to bloom at times, especially if they're kept as indoor container plants. A natural habitat of your plants can provide clues about what growing conditions and seasonal cycles they might need to bloom. Supplying winter cold, summer heat, fertilizer, or more intense light may be all that's needed to encourage successful flowering on even your most stubborn plants. Most succulents need high temperatures in the summer months to set their blooming chemistry, and unfortunately, climate-controlled homes just do not provide the needed temperature extremes. Many indoor succulents, even those kept in your sunniest windows, will never bloom simply because of the temperature. Put such plants in cool areas for the winter months to trick them. Photoperiodicity is important in setting the biological clocks of all organisms, from humans to plants. Some succulents, like holiday cacti, need long night, short day conditions, as well as cool temperatures to initiate flower buds. For many other succulents, it's increasing day length paired with warm spring temperatures that signal buds to bloom. Another issue keeping many indoor succulents from blooming is the receiving of supplemental light to artificially lengthen or shorten the nights, which can encourage faster growth, but will always interfere with flowering. When planting, remove your plants from their nursery pots and replant them immediately, making sure that the soil level remains the same depth on the plant. You'll want to repot most succulents every 2 to 3 years to refresh the soil and free up the roots. Once established, however, your succulents will also benefit from a layer of pebbles, pea gravel, tumbled glass, shells, or other decorative pieces spread on top of the soil around your plants. This helps prevent pests and weeds and can help bring out the best colors in your succulents. Top dressing, as it's known, can be used to help hold the soil in place and give your arrangements a professional touch. Covering the soil not only makes for an attractive arrangement, but it can help protect succulent leaves from standing water and rot too. Top dressing can also help keep the soil in place when watering, preventing the arrangement from shifting very much over time. It can also help reduce the amount of dust that flies up when you water, which will dirty your plants. The planting possibilities using succulents are endless. The different colors, textures, and habits make them the most interesting container trough plants. Succulents are beautiful rock garden plants too. With a wide variety of bloom times, there will always be something with color in your garden if you plant succulents and cacti. So that is the end of my talk. If you learn anything, I will drop my Venmo in the chat, and I'm taking questions now.
All right, fantastic. Thank you so much, Annie. Let's give her just a little quick clappy. Thank you so much. We do have a couple questions already for you. The first one, which stuck out to me since I recognized it, why not Miracle-Gro?
Oh, Miracle-Gro. Miracle-Gro is a chemical-based succulent fertilizer, particularly, and it's not water-soluble. So the granules will sit on your plants if they land on the leaves, and those chemicals will soak into the plants instead of soaking into the water. So that will burn your plants 100% of the time.
Okay, fantastic. You had a visceral reaction to Miracle-Gro. So I wanted to get that one out of the way real quick. Okay, and then we've got another question here from Judy Bishop here. I know this is just a nickname for this succulent, Burrow's Tail. Are you familiar with Burrow's Tail?
Absolutely.
Okay. She says they really don't have a root, just a stem, and are so easy to start a new plant. Why is this?
That is actually all to do with their habit. So okay. That sedum plant it naturally grows on cliff faces and in very tropical climates. So it wants to have the leaves very, very loose so that when rocks or anything tumble down the cliff, it'll knock the leaves loose and those leaves will land on new rocks and plant new plants.
Make their
it's
way into the
very interesting rock. Survival method.
Yeah, great, awesome. Okay, question from Will here. Are succulents good for a screened in porch that gets indirect sun, or do they need direct sun for at least for a certain amount of the day? Should they be moved in and out? At least here, like maybe here in Missouri, I know you're not here, you're in LA, but
yeah.
We get pretty harsh sun for certain amounts of the day, and then, you know.
Yeah, no, so screened-in porches are usually great. Succulents are a little bit easier than cacti in the most part. There's plants like sempervivums, which are gorgeous plants. They look a lot like echeverias, but they're from the Alps. And so they can survive in cold temperatures. They can get snowed on. I believe they can survive down to the negative 20s Fahrenheit, I believe. So they can actually be grown outdoors year round in Kansas. And there's a bunch of plants like that where all you have to do is look at the area that they came from and you can find somebody that will grow for you in any area you want to grow it.
Okay. So just going off of that, you mentioned different grow zones. Like you said, LA was like a 10, sorry, but it's yep. All kind of new tech terminology. LA was in one area, the Midwest kind of was like a 6 or something. Are yep. there different succulents that are designated to grow best in particular grow zones?
Absolutely. Okay. In fact, if you were to Google succulents that grow in USDA plant hardiness zone 6, you would have an entire list or multiple lists show up on your Google search of plants that will not only grow, but thrive in your environments and that can be grown outdoors year round.
Awesome, awesome. That is very helpful. I think I will start there since everything I've tried to grow has grayed or browned out almost immediately. Probably because I'm doing it poorly. Our succulents, we did that one. What potting soil should I get for my echeveria?
Echeveria, yes. Or echeveria, depending. Echeveria is the American and echeveria is the British. It really just depends on what you want. But so potting soil, you can just get a bag of potting soil mix from the store. Cactus mix is great. And that usually comes with about 25% perlite or crushed pumice mixed into it already. And that will be okay for your plants, but if you really want to encourage their growth and really want to encourage their health, you should also add additional rocks to that mix. You can even add a little bit of sand that is coarse enough that the roots will do the same thing it would through rocks.
Okay, so it sounds like to me that succulents are unlike everything that naturally comes to my mind when I think about growing a plant. You're talking about throwing sand
basically.
And rocks at these things. What is their deal?
They most succulents, and this is an oversimplification, some of them are definitely drama queens, but most succulents really do thrive on neglect, which is why I tout them so heavily to people who aren't plant people or who have black thumbs or whatever, you know? It's really, really easy to find a succulent that you can thrive with whatever time and energy and care you have to give it.
Okay.
Like I mentioned, sempervivums, amazing in the area that y'all are in. Absolutely amazing. They can be grown outdoors year round. You'll only need to water them once a week. And some of them, you can Google the gold nugget sempervivum. I'll put that in the chat. And that is one of my favorite plants. It is absolutely stunning. It is bright red and bright yellow and it blooms and it's stunning and you don't even have to do anything with it except water it once a week.
Nice. Okay, I'm gonna definitely put that in the chat because I'm gonna have to remember that one. All right. We got another one here. I've been trying to get, this is from Mary Lou and Roger. One of them has been trying to get their Apuntia.
Prickly
pear, in parentheses, established outside. It's native to the area, but they're having trouble, not having a lot of success. Any suggestions? Oh, looky there.
Got one right here.
Okay.
So these plants are really great because these ones are from the high deserts of California and Mexico. So these ones can also be grown outdoors year round in your area. These are one of the only cactus species that can be grown in the snow, but they can survive to around 0 Fahrenheit. And
any ideas why that it wouldn't be growing so well currently? Anything you could add to it or you'd want to keep away from it, anything like that?
If it's newly established, you're going to want to make sure that the soil it's in isn't a clay soil because it's from those high desert regions. So it's used to the rocky soil. Something I have to deal with a lot. I have a small gardening business. I have a few clients that I work with in California. One of the main things is when they want succulents in habitat or cacti in habitat, working around the clay soil and amending the actual soil of your ground, because that's just as important as planting it in a pot.
Right. Roger, are you guys in Clay County?
We are. There's veins of rock that run through, but we're mostly just clay in here.
Yeah. Yeah. That's I wouldn't be surprised. That's okay. That makes total sense. Thank you so much, Annie. Let's give another round of applause for all of her information, all of her expertise. That was a lot of information. If you, Annie, if you're interested in sharing any of that information with us, some of those details, we have a private Facebook page where we will often give our speakers an opportunity to share some of that information with us, some of those details. If you're interested in sharing that, we would love it. I know there are a lot of interested parties, beginners like me who have got a house with a lot of fake plants in it. Life around here. So if you're interested in that, let's stay in contact after the Zoom and we'll get some of that from you.
Yeah, if anybody else has any more questions that come up, I'll be back on that in a little bit here.
Absolutely, fantastic. And we have got Annie's, her social media information and Facebook page. If you scroll up in the chat, we can find all that. And I will list it again one more time. We'll get Nikki to list it in the chat one more time so we can find her again. Let's give one more round of applause. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. We'll do it all this. It's all quiet. All right. Thank you so much. All right. And with that, we are going to welcome back Sage Cornelius. Sage has got, we've got a little bit of time here. There they are, the chubby plant people. All right. We got enough time and Sage has got a couple songs for us. So we usually end with one song, but I'm loving this music so much that we're going to get two. So Sage, why don't you play us one song and then I'll come back and say a few more things. And then you can end this session, this gathering with one more and roll us out. That sound good to you?
Great. Sounds great. Let's rock.
Cool.
All right. I'm going to go ahead and attach my Facebook page. I've been getting kind of some messages on people like where they can find me and stuff. So just follow that link and that's my Facebook page. I'll be updating you guys on what I'll be doing. But this is a song. It's an unreleased song. The song's called The Chapel. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. All right. So I had to fall backwards. That was so good. All right. All right. I'm glad that I asked for two more because I need more of that. All right. If you want to just keep going even after we're done, that would be totally fine too. All right. I'm gonna say a couple things here. So we're gonna finish up. I usually ask at this point. We're gonna wrap up for today. As everyone knows, Kansas City Oasis is a 501c3 organization. We run completely by our volunteers and by all of you donating and giving your time and your financial resources to this organization. So if you are willing and able, please head over to kansascityoasis.org/donate and give what you are able at this time to our organization. If you can, follow the links in the chat and give what you can to Sage and to Annie. Follow them online, follow them on Facebook, see what they're up to. Appreciate their art and their skills. Thank them for being here with us this morning. We value them. We thank them for being here. Thank you, Mark, also. He had to be here, I think, but we appreciate him doing that research on what a weird year that was. I think we're going to rival it this year, too. That being said, please, everyone, enjoy your holiday weekend. Keep a safe distance. Wear your masks. And please remember that the 4th of July doesn't have necessarily the same connotations for us that it has for everyone in this country. So keep that in mind as you're celebrating and remembering the founding of this country. That being said, Sage, please play us out. We love you. We'll see you all next week.
Awesome. Thank you for having me. And thanks again, man, for being such the awesome moderator, MC dude. You rock, brother. Awesome. This last one is going to be, I'm heavily influenced by composers like Hans Zimmer, the dude, he did like the Batman soundtrack. He did Prince of Egypt, Gladiator, all these epic songs. And so do I got any Game of Thrones fans here? Any Game of Thrones people? Well, right on. Awesome. Cool. So this goes out to all my Game of Thrones, Skyrim people. I wrote this song. I wanted to create a song where like I'm a skeleton king raising an army of the undead and we're all marching into battle. You know what I'm saying? So you guys will see the skeletons with the shields and swords and bows and arrows. This is a song that I've yet to release, but I will release soon. This song is called Sacred Stones.
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for being here. Have a great week. Take care of each other. Take care of yourself, because you deserve it. You really, really do. We love you guys. We'll see you next week.